Well, it's very nice to be sitting here poolside at the Ibiza Grand Hotel and be able to say good morning, Nile Rodgers.
Good morning, my dear.
Ibiza, is this your first time here?
Yes.
It is. What's your first impression when you arrived here? What do you think? What do you think of our island?
It's amazing.
Really?
I love this. I find it unusual at best, and maybe some other horrible word that I couldn't. That I haven't been here before. It seems almost impossible, but I have a busy life. There are a lot of places to go, but I've heard of it for a gazillion years and I just never got here. And now that I've been, I'm coming back in just a few weeks.
Yes, so, you are for the 1-2-3 festival.
Yeah, so, and I have a feeling that's the beginning of a long relationship because I've just had 4 or 5 offers, so.
I was just gonna ask, and now that you've been here and feeling the way you do in such a short period of time, do you think it's going to inspire you musically?
Well, it already has, because the people that I've intersected with, in this space, we have a certain magical thing. Now, maybe it was just the initial connection and we haven't tried anything artistically, but when we come back, I'm going to be here with 3 of my best friends that I work with all the time. I work with Sting all the time. I work with Elton all the time, and Lenny. And then a lot of the DJs are friends of mine. Matter of fact, the woman that was just with Etienne, Scarlett Etienne, Felix the House Cat, and now I met Geta. I met Geta. Yeah. And he and I have been trying to hook up for like 80 gazillion years.
Really?
And it was the same thing, like Daft Punk. And we've been trying to hook up for 80 million years. The next thing you know, they knock on the door of my apartment, and there they are, and something magic happens. So,
and something magic is happening with Daft Punk, but we're not allowed to talk about it.
Right, it's right.
Yesterday in your keynote presentation with Pete Tong, you talked about, you know, jealousy in such a positive way, because it's not often spoken about on that level in the music industry. You know, there's in any industry, really. You know, What is it? What makes you jealous now? What artists are doing stuff now that makes you go ah? What, like you said yesterday many times, like, what that shit?
Wow. Now what's really happening now is the movement in general is making me jealous, because I thought that I wasn't going to be inspired to do anything, for lack of a better word, commercial anymore, even though the music I'm doing is commercial. I'm doing big Broadway shows and stuff. But I never thought that I wanted to be in the competitive dance market again, because just think about it in my terms. Just do the basic math. I sold 28 million albums with Madonna, 19 million albums with Bowie. You know, what we used to call a flop was 2 or 3 million albums. So it doesn't inspire me, but the thing is that I never did music for plaques and symbols and stuff like that, money anyway. Money was always just a positive byproduct of doing a good job. So now I want to do a good job again, and I want to do competitive music. That seems odd to me, because I never thought that I would go, and it doesn't feel like going backwards, but I never thought that I would go back to that place. Because the music business that I knew, for me, feels like it completely imploded. Like I a few years ago, I walked into Atlantic Records. I have the only triple platinum record there. So there's a thing now where we're, at least what it looked like 5 years ago, we were disconnected from the history. But what I saw when I landed here was, not only are we connected to the history, the young people who weren't even born when disco started, no disco. So it seems like what's happening now is youth is starting to, they either want to understand where they're getting the samples from, where they're getting the essence of what they're doing is from, or they just like it. I don't know why, or I don't know what the motivation is, but that's the reality. And I know it's the reality because I can look out at my audience and see 17-year-olds singing our B-sides.
What do you think about IMS in general, the concept, what Pete and Danny and the other founders have been putting together over the last 5 years? You know, it's your first time in Ibiza. You came because Pete invited you to be a part of the IMS. What do you think about it? Have you enjoyed it? Have you met?
So far, I hate to do this because I really don't like to use superlatives and say this is the best and that's the best, because it's all based on people's experience and their own filter. But this is the best I've ever been to. The networking has been incredible. Plus, I met Giorgio Moroder. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? All my life, I have idolized this dude and tried to copy his stuff. And then when he explained to me what he did, and I was like,
I was like, going, man, I'm gonna go play in Giorgio's band. I wanna be like.
When I said yesterday that jealousy was the greatest motivator, it's the single greatest motivator. Now I absolutely reconfirm it, because after talking to Giorgio and he was talking about what he did, well, he got turned onto electronic music with the exact same composers I got turned onto. Right, so he was listening to Switched On Bach, Walter Carlos, and all that stuff, Clockwork Orange. And he says when he went in and got the demonstration, the person played the note and on the oscillator, and it just lasted forever. And he said it lasted for longer than any bassoon player could play it, any saxophone player could play it, and just went forever. And he was just, oh my God, what can I do with something like that?
Yeah.
And all of his music were workarounds. They didn't have the technology to do what he did, so they figured out a way to make. Moving each oscillator and just hitting one button. And I was like, are you kidding me? Here I'm thinking he's playing it. Then I thought he had a sequencer. He didn't even have that. They were patching and going note to note. Unbelievable.
And like I said, it's the main thing. It's jealousy. I was so jealous. I was so obsessed. I couldn't sleep. And I dreamt, I want your love. It's the truth. It's the only song I've ever dreamt.
So that's why this is the best to me. I mean, I've envied Giorgio. I've always tried to imitate him. And then when I found out he was trying to imitate someone else, I was like, going, that's hysterical to
me. Do the math again.
right. So the jealousy factor was huge. But it's not jealousy and envy from a point it's not mean-spirited. It's you got something that I want. You know, it's not like the conquistadores and I want to take your gold. It's like you have something that I want. Once I get it. Well, yeah, you can share it with me if you like, but if you don't share it with me, I'm going to figure it out.
I'm taking it straight from
you. I'm going to take it and I'm going to write a new song.
As I said, it's an absolute honor to meet you. And thank you for joining us on DJ Sounds. And thank you for coming to Ibiza. And we will see you again at 123.
You will indeed. Thank you for having me.
Nile Rodgers.
You still got to tell us about that night at Studio 54. People want to hear about that night. Wow. You got turned away.
So what happened was, so what Pete's referring to is that, so our music is pumping inside, right? So everybody inside is dancing all of our songs. And the thing that was cool about Studio 54 is that obviously they had to appeal to the pop crowd, what they used to call I know I'm in Europe, but they used to call it the Euro trash crowd or the bridge and tunnel
crowd. Name it.
That's what they used to say. So they wanted to hear all of the pop current stuff, but they also liked underground music too. They wanted to hear the next gen of what was going to rock the dance floor. So our record, Everybody Dance, was actually more popular than Dance Dance Dance. So Grace Jones heard Everybody Dance and said, I want those guys to produce me. So she got in touch with us and she says, okay, darling, this is what you do. I sound terrible doing Grace, but she sort of sounds like Marlene Dietrich or something, like Marlene Dietrich from Jamaica. So she says, all right, Nile, darling, this is what you do. Is you tell them you're personal friends of Grace and just say that that's it. You're personal friends of Grace Jones and they'll let you in. So we go to the stage door, which is what she instructs us to do. We knock on the door and say, we don't say the personal friends of Grace, but we say, yo, man, you know, we're Chic, we're personal friends of Grace Jones. And the guy looks at us, I mean, he wanted to laugh, but he slams the door on our faces and says, fuck off. And we're like, we're banging on the door. No, it's a true story. She told us. She said exactly this. So we're thinking that this is like rock and roll code. Personal friends of Grace. So we're trying to get it right. Yo, we're personal friends. They're personal friends. I'm a personal friend. We're personal friends of Grace. We're personal friends of Grace. Naya, tell them you're a personal friend. You're a personal friend of Grace. No, fuck off. So we went around the corner to my apartment, which was on 52nd Street. The back door of Studio 54 is on 53rd Street. And so we went to my house and we started going. This is the true story. We went there and started going. Studio 54. Fuck off. Aw, fuck off. Fuck Studio 54. Fuck off. And we got into it. You should have seen it. If you were a fly on the wall, Bernard and I, we were doing choreography and we were like, fuck off.